again today. And I want to thank God for my pastor.
Amen.
See his life, and how he lived his life, changed my life. I don't got saved, but when I come here, I don't do a lot of things I'm supposed to do. But I ain't never seen a man preach the true word of God like he does and live it.
Amen.
I'm to my living, live. And that's why I love him so much. It changed my life around. To be in God's word, you have to live it.
That's
and I
right.
got that from my pastor. He lived that word out. The way he preached the words of the Bible, he lived it out. Another man down there preached the word. I love him too. I met him like I know Pastor, but he preached the word and he lived it too, same way. And I love pastors like that because we got so many people in the world today saying a pastor wasn't called to be pastor, but they're up there trying to get money or something. But praise God about that. Anyway, I always wanted to be the best basketball player to ever live. I was 5'11". I started playing when I was 8 years old. Playing in my backyard, playing different rain, snow, going and play ball. And I wanted to be the best basketball player to ever live. And my sister and I, my sister was an educated person. She finished Michigan State. She became a pharmacist. She's living in Raleigh right now, retired from being a pharmacist. And the education was there. But I wanted to be a basketball player. I'm like Mr. Goode, Mr. Jess was saying, Mr. Goode saying, when that man was up here preaching about last night, I thought playing basketball and messing with all the women I could mess with, that was a man. But that's a bunch of baloney. That's not true. Until I learned about the word of God.
Yeah.
But that's what I had in my mind. That's why I wanted to be messing with all the women and play basketball and be the best little man that ever played the game. I accomplished that. Everywhere we used to go, it used to be packed with people. It used to be packed. People used to, that's him and Logan, that's this, that's that. It used to be praising him and Logan, praising him and Logan. The papers, everywhere you write about it. I'm a Hall of Fame. I was inducted to the Hall of Fame with Coach K and the owner of the Carolina Panthers and a lot of other great men in 2002. He was inducted to the Hall of Fame. And I had 1,000 trophies. I had a trophy about that tall. I had 1,000 trophies. Mm-hmm. But I had in mind, I want to be the basketball player. Mm-hmm. And I want to be the best player that ever played, a little bit that ever played. I want to be recognized. And I was at that time. And I was. But I went 4 years in high school.
Come on.
4 years in college. And couldn't read or write. And the genes was there. It was in because my sister, she was a smart lady. It was there, but I had other plans in my mind I think was the best thing to be with best women and play basketball. And I didn't try to study. All I did was play ball and run around with play ball, run around with women. And I was doing good. I got drafted by Seattle in the fourth round. I got drafted by Oklahoma first. And Oakland offered me more money than Seattle Suicide. I was making $155,000 for 3 years. And I got a $20,000 bonus. They put it in my head, had $20,000 in my hand. And I was doing good. We won the championship my first year in the pro. That was 1968. We won the championship there at Oakland Oaks. And Rick Berry, Doug Moe, Larry Brown, all the guys on the team when we won the championship. And they used to say, why you talk like you do? You don't talk like you have any education. You don't talk like you know anything. And I said, well, I'm playing basketball. I got what I want. I got money in my pocket. I don't need to talk. I don't need to say anything. All I need to do is play ball. And I was in college. I weighed 175. In the pros, I was 5'11". I weighed 210 pounds. And 5'11". How can you play ball and jump like I can jump, could jump, or run around like I did? Then I got hurt. I had 15 operations on my right knee. They took out my kneecap back there. They took the muscle out of my thigh and put it on my knee. And when I came home, I couldn't play no ball every time. When I came home, and all these people used to be at the games, used to worship me and stuff. They wouldn't even give me a job. And you know why? They said I didn't have the right education. And they would not give me a job. So I got to drinking. I tried to kill myself several times, drinking alcohol. Even pastor, I used to teach Brother Chris Sunday school class. And I used to drink that syrup, because syrup was in the coffee mills. I used to drink that. Pastor, you can't teach. You can't come here and teach them young kids the Bible and stuff you're doing with that syrup and stuff. So he took me off of that. And that's what I learned about his life and changed my life around. But anyway, they wouldn't give me a job. I was just started drinking, tried to kill myself several times. But in 1979, I tried to kill myself. And a pastor named Pastor A. Day, give him a black mouth, called me up and said, we got somebody who can change your life, who can make you a better person. I said, I just tried to kill myself. And I can't talk to kids, like tell kids lies anymore. All I want to do is die and not to live anymore. I'm getting tired of lying. But he said, I got somebody to change your life. So he came to my house. And I brought this guy named Odd White. I brought him to church with me last night. Some of the members met him. His name Odd White. He's with Pastor A. Day. And they took me to the church. It was on a Friday, 1979. And I got saved. It changed my life. It seemed like when I went to that church and I raised my hand up, it seemed like all that stuff I had in me, I had all that alcohol, all the pills, all that syrup, all that, just came out of me. And I said, God.
Oh, come on.
I said, God, I do not want to know nobody. Because I used to go take the driver's test, they used to have to read it to me. And I'd take it when they read it to me, and I ask the person. But I said, I don't want nobody to tell me your word. I want to learn how to read your word myself and know about it myself. So I locked myself in a house, not locked myself in there, but I bought me 3 Bibles. And I started reading, writing words I didn't know, and asking somebody words and stuff. And I read for 3 years I did it. I had a King James, I had a New International Bible. And 3 years I did that. And the words I didn't know, I wrote down. And I tell you,
come on.
Praise God. I can read anything. Take the test from my good myself.
Come on.
And I can, oh Lord God. Every day I read the Bible from 3:30 to 4:30 and 10:30 in the morning to 4:30 in the evening. Every day. I studied the Bible, and I got something I had written down, and I had read, and I think it would be a help for all of us, because that pastor last night, and the pastor always said this, and always preached this, but that guy just, he did a great job last night on getting how us brothers and sisters, we all be able to live our life, and we all be a witness to Christian men and women. We should live like the world. We should be a witness to the world.
Amen.
We should have the world in the church. We should go get the world and bring them into the church and get them saved.
Come on. Uh-huh.
But the name of it is the Freedom Prince of God. I am a work of art. That's what God. I am a work of art signed by God. That's everybody here. We got something to do in this world. We got to be out there on the battlefield. Out there talking to Christian men and women. I mean, talking to them sinners and drug addicts and dope addicts. We should be out there talking to them and bringing them to the church. And Satan be saying, I have on me faithful praise of God. Neither will there ever be another person like me. I have a job to do in this life that no other can do. And that's us. No, you got a person, relationship with God. God has something for you to do. And that's how they're bringing souls into the kingdom of God. And until we go home, that's what we're supposed to be doing.
Amen.
And Pastor preached it all the time. And that young man was up here last night, he said the same thing. We have a work to do. We should be honoring one another in the church. We should be out there helping one another, praying for one another, going out there helping other souls come to the kingdom. And it's Ephesians 2:10. It says, Ephesians 2:10, you can read up when you get home. It says that For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared have asked for us to do. And that's what we should be doing.
Amen.
And I know this is my heart. Psalms of Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your understanding. In all your ways acknowledge me, and I will direct your paths. And God will direct our paths. He will. And that's in Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Every person is a unique expression of God's love and desire. Look at everything through the cross. We should look at everything we do through the cross of God who died for us and rose on the third day for our sin. Thank you. This is my testimony.